So thank you everyone for joining us for the management of breast cancer patients during the COVID-19 pandemic webinar. Without wasting any further time, I would like to introduce Dr. Ashish Jakhatia, who is a surgical oncologist from GMCH Cancer Hospital, Udaipur. Sir, welcome. Sir, I request you to please give the welcome remarks. Over to you, sir.
Hi, hello everyone. I hope all the panelists and the presenter have joined in. So it is a great idea to have this discussion right on at this time, because we are right now we are in a very difficult time and having a lot of decision making problems. So I'll invite further Dr. Rohan to start his presentations, and I'll welcome all the panelists, Dr. Mandeep, Dr. Nishant, and Dr. Akash. So after the presentation, we'll start the panel discussion. So over to Dr. Rohan now.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
Okay, all right. Good evening, everyone. I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to talk on this very important issue. And all of us are going through a very tough time because of the second wave of corona. And this second wave has hit us hard and hit us very close to home as well. So I hope all of you are keeping safe. I bring greetings from CK Birla Hospital, which is a multi-speciality hospital. And I take care of the breast unit at this hospital. We all know that we're going through the second wave of COVID-19. This infection started in 2019. We had a first wave, but the second wave has been of, the numbers have been huge. And till last week, we were hitting record highs every day. The numbers have slightly reduced, but the situation is still critical. We know that COVID can present with a myriad of symptoms, and it has almost become a reflex now to get COVID testing done. If anyone presents with any symptoms, I think so that's our first go-to, that we need to rule out COVID. Now, given the mutations which are occurring and the lethargic vaccination drive in our country, I feel that we will be seeing another wave very soon. So this is what you can say, the new normal, and all of us need to adapt our practice to this new normal so that our patients don't suffer. Italy and America, they had a huge first wave, and their learnings from the first wave, particularly regarding breast cancer, were that after the first wave got over and the lockdowns got over, they had a sudden surge of breast cancer patients. And these breast cancer patients came to them at a later stage. The treatments also got delayed. Now, my personal experience in the first wave, the hospital where I practice, we weren't admitting COVID patients. So my practice did not suffer, although I was getting a lot of patients from other hospitals where COVID was being treated. But in the second wave, I think so voluntarily, patients have stopped coming to the hospital. They are using more telemedicine consults. And I think all of us in the next few months will see a surge of breast cancer patients, some of them in late stages as well. Now, I'm sure all of you must be doing teleconsults, and it's a great tool to have during this period, but it has its own drawbacks as well. In our country, unfortunately, some patients think that everything can be solved on teleconsults. And, they would also want treatment to be done on teleconsults, which unfortunately is not possible. You know, physical examination is one of the pillars of triple assessment in a patient with a breast lump. And with teleconsults, we unfortunately cannot carry out physical examination, which is another huge drawback. Of course, there are legal ramifications of teleconsults as well. And I'm sure all of you must have been briefed about how to go about doing a proper teleconsult. A study which was published in Lancet last year, they saw that 928 patients of cancer who got COVID What was observed was that there was a 13% mortality, which was more than twice the death rate in general population. And it was seen that those patients who were elderly patients who had comorbid conditions or male patients, these were the ones who were more likely to get severe COVID infection. Another study from the Chinese population, what they saw that there was a higher risk of invasive ventilation and higher mortality in cancer patients who contracted COVID. In fact, the case fatality rates were twice the general population. They were 7.6% as compared to 3.8% in the general population. So to a certain extent, I would say that the fear of these cancer patients not to come to the hospital is justified. But what is important for us is to stratify these patients. And I guess that is the key in managing breast cancer patients during these times, the stratification of these patients and managing them accordingly. Patients, breast cancer patients who are at an increased incidence of severe disease include elderly patients, patients with COPD, heart conditions, diabetes, CKD, obesity, and smokers. So we need to stratify our patients. There are many societies who've published their stratification guidelines, and I will be touching some of them, but I feel that they are just a starting point. Our problems and you know, our practices are very different from the Western world. And although you can use these guidelines as a starting stone, but we need to modify them according to our own practice. And that's very important. These are the stratifications which were given by ESMO. And according to ESMO, they had divided patients into high priority, medium priority, and low priority. Similarly, the Society of Breast Surgeons of America, they divided it into category A, B, and C, which I'll be covering later on. So in terms of OPD visits, high priority was given to patients who were newly diagnosed invasive breast cancers, breast cancer during pregnancy, patients who were suffering from surgical complications. Newly diagnosed non-invasive breast cancer patients, follow-ups and screening mammograms. So screening mammograms at a lot of places were suspended, and the non-invasive breast cancers and the follow-up visits, they recommended that teleconsults be done for these patients. Another stratification criteria, this is from the Italian group, which almost mirrors the ESMO recommendations. As surgical oncologists, the stratification, the highest priority should be given to breast cancer patients who are post-NACT and are waiting for surgery. Upfront invasive breast cancers where it has been determined by the tumor board that they need surgery and no neoadjuvant treatment can be offered to them. Breast cancer during pregnancy and excision of a malignant recurrence, provided there's no systemic disease. Patients who are early stage breast cancers, ER/PR positive, HER2/neu negative, they were given medium priority. And a lot of studies have shown that these patients, if there was a resource crunch and surgery cannot be offered to them immediately, they can be put on neoadjuvant endocrine therapy and the surgery can be done whenever the situation improves and OT services are available. Low priority was given to non-invasive breast cancer, except for high-grade DCIS. Again, if they were ER/PR positive, they can be started on endocrine treatment and autologous reconstruction and prophylactic surgeries. So as I told you, the American Society, they divided into priority A, B, and C. Priority A being those patients who require immediate care. Priority B being those patients where the treatment can be deferred by 6 to 12 weeks without hampering the breast cancer outcomes. So if you have an abscess or a hematoma post-surgery, these are patients who are priority A and you need to surgically address them without any delay. Patients who've completed neoadjuvant therapy for breast cancer, they need to be operated as soon as institutional resources are available. Triple negative breast cancer and HER2/neu positive patients, the role of neoadjuvant chemotherapy and HER2-directed therapy can be discussed with them. Patients who are already on neoadjuvant therapy but finishing their treatment or progressing on their treatment, they can undergo surgery. Or if an alternate regime can be started for them, that is another thing which can be discussed in the tumor board. Again, low-risk patients, patients with T1, T2 disease, ER, PR positive, you can put them on neoadjuvant endocrine therapy. In the second wave, when there was an oxygen crunch, I had to put one of my patients on neoadjuvant endocrine therapy because of two reasons. One, because the patient was really scared, and because of an oxygen crisis at the hospital. Another situation, I think so, which will be discussed, I saw the panel discussion, and a lot of interesting case scenarios have been included by Dr. Ashish, which will be discussed later. But another scenario is a patient who is a low-risk patient, but the patient gets COVID and, you know, asymptomatic or low-risk COVID. That's another patient where we can consider endocrine therapy in those patients. Now, the changes in surgical practice, the new normal for us these days is routine pre-op COVID testing. In fact, some institutes are even testing the attendance for COVID before they are allowed admission. Same day admission and daycare surgery. I've done a couple of breast conservation surgeries as daycare. In fact, having a very good anesthesia team also helps. When the oxygen crunch was going on, we did a couple of cases in a paravertebral block, which saved on the oxygen as well. There was good pain control and the patients were discharged early as well. Again, no swapping of attendance also reduces the number of people visiting the hospital. That is helpful. Minimal movement inside and outside the theater is something which we've been rigorously and proper PPE. I think so all of us need to be safe to provide proper care to our patients as well. And we should not undermine the importance of proper PPE and hand hygiene during this pandemic. Fertility preservation was something which these procedures were reduced or suspended. Even in America, Italy, these procedures were suspended. And those patients who were receiving chemotherapy and were keen on fertility preservation, LHRH analogs were added to them to reduce the ovarian damage. From a medical oncology standpoint, according to ESMO, early breast cancer, your high priority patients are those who are already undergoing neoadjuvant chemotherapy, and chemotherapy should continue in these patients, those who are receiving neoadjuvant or adjuvant regimes. Postmenopausal stage 1 breast cancer, they fall in your medium priority, and adjuvant trastuzumab can be postponed for 6 to 8 weeks if you determine that there is a patient who's at a high risk of getting complicated COVID. Patients with oncological emergency should be managed on a priority basis. Metastatic breast cancer patients in whom therapy is likely to improve outcomes, you need to initiate chemotherapy, endocrine, or targeted therapy. Continue therapy for patients who are already on neoadjuvant or adjuvant chemo. Patients who are progressing on neoadjuvant therapy, you either refer them to the surgical colleagues or you change the systemic therapy in these patients. Metastatic breast cancer patients where therapy is unlikely to improve outcomes, chemotherapy can be deferred for some time. And HER2-new positive patients who've completed more than 2 years of maintenance targeted therapy with minimal disease burden, you can consider stopping the therapy and monitor them on a regular basis. Wherever possible, molecular tests should be conducted. Wherever we can avoid chemotherapy, that is good in these patients as that would prevent immune suppression and the risk of getting COVID. Shift to 2 to 3 weekly regimes instead of weekly regimes. This is, I guess, become a standard practice. Patients were shifted to two or three weekly regimes, and GCSF were being routinely used to prevent neutropenia. Antibiotics were also being added, and steroids were being limited to prevent further immunosuppression. I've already discussed the role of neoadjuvant endocrine therapy in low-risk patients. The LHRH analogs, instead of a monthly dosing, three-monthly dosing is something which is more feasible. And in a lot of countries, these doses were being administered at home or as a drive-through injection. This is something which we can consider in our setup as well. Zoledronic acid, if not urgently indicated, you can also move to a three-monthly regime, especially in metastatic breast cancer patients. And adjuvant HER2 new therapy in a select group, in the low-risk group, instead of a one-year treatment, one can even consider a six-month treatment. Port flushing can be easily deferred by 3 months. Those patients who are candidates for CanAssist or other molecular tests should be offered this test, as these tests tell us about the recurrence rate. And if the patient has a low risk of recurrence, chemotherapy can be avoided. These tests are carried out on tissue blocks, and one can use them to safely avoid chemotherapy. From the radiation oncology perspective, before I talk about the radiation oncology, one thing about medical oncology, what we've been doing at our setup in the daycare also, is we need to preserve staff as well. Staff, our nurses, are at a constant risk of getting COVID. So staff preservation is something which all of us should think about for the next few months, and maybe having a roster where not all the nurses are coming in, that can prevent them from getting exposed to multiple patients and getting COVID. From the radiation oncology standpoint, high priority patients are those who are already on radiotherapy, or they have an oncological emergency like a spinal cord compression or symptomatic brain metastasis. Adjuvant radiotherapy in high-risk patients like inflammatory breast cancer, triple negatives, HER2 new positives, or locally advanced breast cancers. Patients who are less than 65 years with stage 1 or 2 with ERPR positivity, radiotherapy can be deferred by a few weeks if there is a resource crunch. And low-risk patients, more than 70 with stage 1, stage 2 ERPR positivity, and those who are node negative, one can even think about omitting radiotherapy in these patients. So radiotherapy can be omitted for patients 65 years or above with IDC up to 3 centimeters, with clear margins, node negative, and hormone positive. Hypofractionation should be done for all the patients where the therapy can get over in 3 weeks instead of 5 weeks and an additional boost. So hypofractionation is something which radiotherapists are routinely practicing. Wherever possible, the radiotherapy can be delivered in 5 fractions. And boost can be omitted in select group of patients who are low risk. One can omit boost radiotherapy in these patients as well. Another common phone call which all of us are receiving these days is from breast cancer patients, and their question is whether they can receive the vaccine or not. So vaccination is safe. If the patient is undergoing chemotherapy, the patient can receive the vaccine once the WBC counts have recovered. So, you can tell them to receive therapy in between cycles as well. Patients on hormonal therapy can also get a vaccination done. A trial in a small group of patients has shown that because of some amount of immune suppression, maybe breast cancer patients or cancer patients in general might not mount the same immune response to the vaccine as a normal patient, but we still need more data on this. Another situation is, and I'm sure all of you must have encountered breast cancer patients testing positive for COVID. So early identification of symptoms and initiation of treatment is the key. And it needs to be a multidisciplinary treatment where the oncologist, internal medicine team, and the pulmonologist all are jointly treating this patient. During this period, surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy needs to be deferred. patients who are on endocrine therapy, at least in my our patients, we continued endocrine therapy. We did discuss with the internal medicine and the pulmonology colleagues if they were on tamoxifen, whether to put them on blood thinners or not. That is something which can be discussed as a multidisciplinary approach. So to end, ladies and gentlemen, COVID in India is going to continue for some time, and we need to adjust to this new normal, and we need to alter our treatment according to the situation. We can use the guidelines which I have shown to you, but we need to modify them according to our own needs, and we need to figure out Indian solutions to Indian problems. We need to encourage vaccination even in our cancer patients. And as healthcare workers, it is very important that we keep ourselves safe as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I now request our moderator, Dr. Ashish, to please start the panel discussion. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, very nice presentation. You have covered most of the things which we are going to discuss in next few slides. So I'll just share the screen. I hope all the panelists have joined in. Hi, Dr. Akash.
Yes, sir. All four panelists have joined in, sir.
Okay. So can you see the screen?
So not yet.
Okay. Just a moment.
Sir, if you're facing any difficulties, should I share the screen?
Yes, just wait for
sure.
2 seconds. I'm trying to. Is it visible now?
No, sir, not visible yet.
Okay, then you can share the screen for me, please.
Yeah, sure, sir.
Okay, so we'll start with the case without wasting the time. A 70-year-old lady, PS1, presented to us. She was a known case of Hodgkin's lymphoma, treated in 2012 with R-CHOP-based chemotherapy. So she was presented to us in the last weeks of March 2020 with a case diagnosed CA right breast, clinically T2 and 0 M0. She was strong ERPR positive, HER2 negative, and Ki-67 was 10%. So at that time, the initial panic was going on. But she was advised surgery in next few days. However, she defaulted at that time. And after around 8 or 9 months, she again presented with upstaging. Now the clinical stage was T4B N2 M0. Next, please. So she was not operable right now. So now I'm going to Dr. Nishant. What will be your provisional plan of action? What you will suggest for her?
Hello.
Hi.
Hello, sir. Good evening.
Good evening.
Sir, in this case, we will go for neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Probably starting with the AC regime. AC followed by T, or AC. After giving four cycles of AC, we can plan for the surgery. Then we can go for the taxane part.
Yeah, so for chemotherapy, I'm going to just take an opinion of Dr. Akash, because she is the treated case of lymphoma, and she has received already chemotherapy.
Sir?
So there are chances of toxicity of adriamycin. I think she has received enough dose of adriamycin in her R-CHOP regime. So, hi, Dr. Akash.
Dr. Akash, you'll have to unmute your mic.
Hi, sir. Sir, in a 70-year-old lady who has already...
Ashish, can I come in? Ashish?
Yes, Mandeep, sir.
Then a 70-year-old lady who has already received six cycles of R-CHOP would have received almost 300 milligram per meter square of doxorubicin. So we can either give her taxane alone or docetaxel cyclophosphamide or paclitaxel carboplatin, depending upon the fitness and comorbidity. So these would be the agents that I like to juggle between.
So definitely we discuss
non-anthracycline-based agent.
Yeah. So definitely we discussed this case in our tumor board, and the patient was started on paclitaxel-based chemotherapy. Okay. She was started on paclitaxel-based, I think, two-weekly regime. And after fourth cycle of paclitaxel, she developed an asymptomatic COVID-19 infection. Fortunately, she recovered well, and now it's almost 3 weeks post-infection of the COVID. So, what do you think, Dr. Akash? Would you like to give more chemotherapy or any other option?
So, I'm not sure if the initial, it will depend upon what the initial plan was. If she gave six, was planned for four, six cycles of paclitaxel or paclicarbo, I'm not sure. But whatever was planned chemotherapy was, I'd like to complete it, and then she should undergo surgery.
Okay. So how long you want to wait? Like, she's already 3 weeks.
Sir, in my patients of breast cancer who had developed COVID and were asymptomatic, I usually start them by fourth week on chemotherapy.
Ah, yes, Mandeep sir, we can hear you.
Yeah, in this case, I would, since it's a ERBR positive, but if you negative case, 10% 70-year-old female. Mm-hmm. And with this current COVID scenario, I would put her on hormone therapy upfront and wait for the situation to get better and operate.
Okay, so
after
you don't
receiving so much chemotherapy.
I think that because it was January 2021, they planned to give chemotherapy. Like everybody
so
else,
there's no point now.
Yeah.
Yes, it's a test-7, it's highly ERPN positive. We can definitely put her on hormone therapy and disease risk at that point of time.
I think your voice is not clear, Dr. Mandeep. I cannot hear you properly.
So what Dr. Mandeep meant was that the other option could have been to give her neoadjuvant endocrine therapy also. I think that is what he meant.
Okay, that is definitely a valid option. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy is a valid option. But because now she presented with a significant progression, and her PS was good, and our medical oncologist was willing to start the chemotherapy. So that's why we took that call, and we put her on chemotherapy. She had a very good response on four cycles of paclitaxel. Even we were discussing to offer the surgery in between or not.
but due to that current oxygen crisis going on, and unfortunately she developed the infection. So we pulled her from the subsequent chemotherapy or surgery, and now we are planning to put her on hormonal therapy for like a month or so, and then we are planning to take a final call.
I would like to add something.
Yeah.
So when we start with the hormone therapy, don't we wait for 3 months minimum period of time?
Definitely, that is the ideal time. So I think 1 month is just for the assessment, and ideally we should wait for at least 3 to 4 months.
Dr. Mandeep is not audible. He is trying to say
something.
Yeah, he's not audible.
Ashish, am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I really agree with what you have done. And as you can assess after some time, after a month or so, and see how the situation is, like, you have to judge. It's not about 3 months now. You have to judge the whether the third wave will come in. And in after a month or so, if the situation is better, then better upgrade after a month or so. We don't know if it's going to be another happy and a third wave again. So that is the first one.
Yes. Any other suggestion, any panelists want to give? Any other suggestion for this patient? Okay, so I'll move on the second case. So these are the guidelines we have already discussed. Now I'm going to discuss the second case. She is like a 55-year-old female. She was diagnosed with inflammatory myopathy. She presented with progressive muscle power loss to our neurologist for around 2 to 3 months history. On all the workup, muscle biopsy, she was diagnosed as a case of inflammatory myopathy. And she was put on steroids and azathioprine by our neurologist. During the treatment, she complained a right breast lump. So it was evaluated by our team, and it was found to be around 2 centimeter lump with mobile axillary lymph nodes. We did all the workup. Biopsy was IDC, weak, ER positive, PR negative, HER2 new was negative, and Ki-67 score was 70%. So can you show the next slide, please? So this was her PET scan. It was a small primary with multiple axillary lymph nodes, level 1, 2, and 3, with significant uptake in the axilla. So there were multiple issues related to the myopathy, COVID-19 situation, and immunocompromised status, as she was already on the steroids and azathioprine. So now going to discuss this scenario with Dr. Mandeep. Sir, can you hear me, Dr. Mandeep?
Yeah, if I'm audible. Yeah.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
It's a triple negative, like ideally looking at it, it's a triple negative node one. And along with that, she also has myopathy. So, again, looking at triple negative, so I would still evaluate the option of going for NACD first.
Okay.
Because it's an N2 disease. And the node which is like, it's a, and Ki-67 index is again 70%. So, she has high chances of throwing up crystal mix. And during this COVID time, obviously, it is difficult to manage patients with this, when she has crystal mix. And I would still evaluate NACD.
Yeah, definitely. Any opinion from Dr. Rohan or Dr. Nishant's side?
I would agree with Dr. Mandeep. Starting on NACT will be better in this patient.
Yeah, so...
I also agree with Dr. Mandeep. NACT would be a better option.
Definitely. So can you go for the next slide, please? So we discussed this patient in our tumor board with our neurologist and medical oncologist. Again, our neurologist was in favor of upfront surgery because he said like the patient was having some paraneoplastic features. Her CPK levels were around 2000 plus. So he was in a favor ki, if you go for the surgery, patient can show the signs of recovery from her myopathy. We can taper down the steroids, immunomodulators, and then we can go for chemotherapy. So there were multiple options. We were thinking of neoadjuvant chemotherapy versus surgery. But finally, we went ahead for right MRM. And the histopathology was T1, N3, M0. She had 18 nodes positive out of 25 with extranodal extension. Grade 3 tumor with lymphovascular invasion. She tolerated the surgery well. So, going towards Dr. Akash now.
Sir, there's a question that I have in mind, but for this lady, I'd like to give dose dense AC by T followed by radiotherapy. I was wondering, sir, what happened to the myopathy? Just intrigued. Yeah.
Yes, so definitely after surgery, we waited for around 1.5 months. Her CPK level came down significantly low. Like pre-surgery, it was around 2500. And post-surgery, it came to around in the range of 300 to 400. And she started saying like her muscle weakness is improving. Though no, any test was done from neurologist, but seeing the CPK levels and clinical features, overall picture was like she showed signs of improvement after surgery in her myopathy. And the dose of steroids was also tapered down, as well as azathioprine.
Sir, from neurologists. As I had mentioned, we like to give dose dense AC by T for the lady.
Okay. And definitely chemotherapy will be the preferred approach over before giving radiotherapy because she is a high risk patient, extensive nodal disease positive.
Yes, sir. So chemotherapy before RT.
Yeah, definitely. Next slide, please. So, I'm going to discuss the third case. She was a 62-year-old female. ECOG 0. She was a gynecologist by occupation. She presented with a right breast lump of around 2 centimeter in size. Clinically, it was T2, N0, M0. The biopsy showed IDC strong ERPR positive, HER2 negative, and the Ki-67 was 10%. Next slide. So she underwent right breast conservation surgery. Histopathology, it was T2, N0, M0. The tumor size was around 2.2 cross 1.5 cross 1.4 centimeter. Margins were free. No LBI. So as we all know, once the doctors are involved in the decision making, the chances of poor treatment goes high. Like first, she was not willing for breast conservation. She was willing for MRM, but however, we told her that the result are same and we can go for right breast conservation surgery. Now, after this report, we offered her the Canisius testing. But initially, she was reluctant. She was to be treated towards an aggressive approach. So she was willing for a chemotherapy protocol. So Dr. Nishant, can you hear me?
Yes.
So what will be your take in this patient further?
Sir, first of all, sentinel node biopsy was done or axillary lymph node dissection was done? Was it?
No. It was a sentinel biopsy with blue dye. And okay. We also sampled few lymph nodes. So all three blue nodes were negative. And we removed three more nodes. All those nodes were also negative. So total 0/6 lymph nodes.
And sir, her ERPR was positive. So we should give her an option of Canisius or other RNA-based genetic testing, Oncotype DX, or maybe... If she
definitely.
So yes, so hopefully all of us are routinely offering the patient the molecular test in this scenario. Yes, just sir. Want to take opinion. She was node negative on the sentinel. How many of you, like Dr. Mandeep or Dr. Rohan, are offering this scan assist to node positive patient, like 1-3 node positive, if she is showing all favorable features in the tumor site?
Definitely, Ashish, it's a one node positive disease and something like that, or even one node macromet, gene signature should be done in such with a positive or negative. I just want to add on this case is that as it's a doctor, so she's a 60-year female. So if you look at the data according to gene signature test, I believe Dr. mentioned because they have more robust data for 60 plus females. Whereas if you have younger females, then cancer has a better data for Indian scenarios. And gene signatures should be definitely done to all these patients because this patient, in COVID times specifically, we can save patients from chemotherapy, repeated hospital visits.
Right, so next slide, please.
So, Dr. Ashish, can I just...
Definitely, Dr. Wan.
Yeah, so your question was whether we are offering these tests to node-positive patients. So I think so it would depend patient to patient. The case which you highlighted, I would definitely offer the CAN assist or an oncotype test for these patients. But if the patient is less than 50, if you have any aggressive features, then I would refrain from doing these molecular tests in such patients.
Yeah, definitely. So, this was her CAN assist score. She fell in the low risk score. So the decision for adjuvant radiotherapy and hormonal therapy was taken. So, next slide, please. So, we don't have a radiation oncologist in our panel, but I would just like to take your opinion regarding the adjuvant radiotherapy protocol in such kind of patients. Like, what protocol you guys are following in such kind of patients? We'll start with Dr. Rohan.
So ever since the pandemic, we have moved from the standard regime to the hyperfractionation one. That's what we are doing for most of us.
Okay, so you are routinely practicing hypofractionated regimes for such in these patients.
Correct.
Great. Dr. Mandeep, Dr. Akash.
Yeah.
Same here.
If Ashish has operated, he would definitely have taken good margins. The margin would be more than around a centimeter all around. And even more than that, I would be even happy with just an APPI.
Dr. Akash?
So we, in fact, pre-epidemic time also, we were routinely practicing hypofractionated RP. It has a DFS advantage in as well as some slight over the survival. We are practicing that. This case, we might have considered, matlab, not in my center, but in places where there is facility, could be considered for APBI.
Yeah, definitely. So we also following the hypofractionated regimes at our center also. And definitely she is a good candidate for APBI also if the centers are practicing that. So she's doing fine after radiotherapy. Now we have started her on hormonal treatment. Next slide, please.
Ashish, so are you able to see the slide? It's on no, case 4.
No, I'm not able to see.
So not even on the phone, sir?
No.
Should I have changed the slide?
Yeah, it's currently on case number. Yeah, it's done. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you, sir.
Yeah, I can see these slides. So, okay, going towards the next case, 26-year-old lady, ECOC0, no medical comorbidities. She presented to us with a clinically T3 N2 M1 isolated bone lesion. And on biopsy, she was HER2 enriched variant. ARPR was negative. And I hope you all will agree that the initial treatment will be neoadjuvant chemotherapy for her. Dr. Akash?
I would agree.
Okay. And
neoadjuvant chemotherapy or with a palliative intent, depending upon what the family agrees, but I would tilt towards a neoadjuvant therapy.
So, she was
actually, like, just one thing.
Yeah.
I just slightly the clinical scenario and the molecular structure doesn't go into place, because you are saying that it's an isolated bone marrow 26-year-old female. Continue-driven disease, and there's no visceral mets at all, and just isolated bone mets, and ERPR is highly negative.
I cannot. Okay. You want to say that with ERPR negative, the chances of bone met are very low.
Yeah, something has to drive the bone mets, huh? So maybe that patient has a component of ERPR positivity. Maybe I am not sure. I would recheck my molecular signature again. For this patient.
Okay. Right.
But
yeah, definitely. That is a very good advice. Like now she has undergone surgery, but I'll do that. I'll again recheck her molecular levels now. Sure. Post-surgical specimen. So she was started on 4-AC-4-taxane based chemotherapy. Once she completed the chemotherapy, there was a partial response in the primary, and there was an isolated lesion at D6 vertebra. Next slide, please. So I don't have a proper image. I took this picture from the radiotherapy planning console today morning only, which can you can see the uptake in the D6. And no other meds. So,
yeah.
Now going towards Dr. Rohan, what is your protocol in these kind of oligometastasis patients? As such, in a routine as well as in the current scenario?
So that would depend again on a case-to-case basis. If the oligometastasis is just to an isolated bone mets, which is amenable to surgical resection, we can even go for surgical resection. In this case, radiotherapy would be given to that area. But if there is an area which is responded, if the primary is also responded and the metastatic site, if it's just an isolated bone mets amenable to surgery, I would go ahead with surgery.
Yeah, definitely. Mandeep, sir?
Ashish, you have already given chemotherapy, and with financial issues, you are not able to give Herceptin anything of her thing. And I think, depending on what is the final pathology report, how much is the response, primary, both lymph nodes and primary. Definitely, this oligometastatic site should be radiated. So the vertebral lesion can be taken care of by radiation. But then you have to discuss further what will you do to prevent a recurrence again. Or I think if the financial issues are still there, if you consider lapatinib tablet, that
would
also add benefit to the
patient. Next slide, please. So, she was planned for a curative surgery. As she was young, again, I would like to discuss with all my surgical colleagues that what will be your choice for reconstruction in this kind of patient in the current scenario?
you would like to go for a simple MRM, or you would plan for a reconstruction option in the same setting in the current scenario?
Whatever scenario, if 26 year female, if you are ever thinking of reconstruction, the reconstruction has to be thought in the primary settings, and that is the best time when you can get a
clear.
Pardon?
Mandeep sir, your voice is not clear. It's breaking too much.
Yeah, I'm on the road honestly. The thing is that I am saying that if reconstruction has to be for a 26-year-old female, if we are ever looking at reconstructive surgery, we have to give her an option of primary reconstruction. There's absolutely no doubt on that. And for this kind of females, even an 80 flap can suffice it. You just need to see where exactly the mode disease burden is, that if it is an upper quadrant, you can leave a breast tissue in the lower quadrant, or if it is a lower quadrant, you can leave some tissue in the upper quadrant and put an LD flap and come out very quickly. If you're doing an MRM with LD flap, even in such scenario, the 3-hour surgery would be enough. So, obviously, secondary reconstructions are an option, but if you are doing a surgery, then the risk for COVID remains the same whether it's a 1.5-hour surgery or a 3-hour surgery. And an LD flap reconstruction should definitely be thought over. Doing a microvascular and all that stuff, definitely I agree, would not be a good sense to do this during COVID times.
Okay.
Sir, I would like to add something.
Yes, Dr. Rohan.
Sir, this is Dr. Nishant.
Sorry, Dr. Nishant.
Yeah, so in this COVID times, most of the guidelines, they say that we don't go for the reconstruction part because it takes time. But if we can do pedicle flaps, and we know LD flap doesn't take much time, or even the tram flap, pedicle flap, it doesn't take much time. If you're doing MRM in an hour, then another 1 or 2 hours, just like that. But young females, they should be offered reconstruction. It is very important.
Definitely.
I agree, Dr. Ashish. I agree that reconstruction should be offered. And as Dr. Mandeep was trying to say, that primary reconstruction would make more sense if this patient wants reconstruction. Of course, there are multiple issues. It being an oligometastatic disease, patient not taking HER2-neo directed therapy. So multiple things need to be discussed. But as Dr. Nishant and Dr. Mandeep said, a pedicle flap versus an MRM, it's just an hour extra, and that can be done. Of course, abdominal flaps, the only thing is a prolonged hospital stay. We need to consider about.
Yes. So, like she was offered the same as discussed by and as advised by you all. But again, her cousin, brother was a surgeon, general surgeon. So, seeing overall picture, he was not ready to give consent for the reconstruction at the current scenario. So, we planned a MRM. She underwent the surgery. Her histopathology was YP T1 N2. She underwent SRS for the D6 lesion. And now she has completed the radiotherapy also. So, Dr. Akash, what do you think will be the best adjuvant protocol for her?
Sir, assuming she has already received 4AC/4P earlier, if we can give her HER2-directed therapy somehow arranged, that would be the best thing to give her. If not, as one of the panelists pointed out, probably we can give lapatinib. But in current era, they will cost almost the same. I think trastuzumab would be better.
Okay. And definitely we'll go by the Dr. Mandeep's advice also. She's young and oligomet. Will go for a repeat molecular profile testing also for this patient.
We can, yes.
Definitely. So, next slide, please. I think this is the last case. Do we have time to discuss this? Or we can answer a few questions from the audience, or we can take a call.
Sir, you can go ahead with the case, or you So we have time.
Okay, we can go ahead. Okay, so I'll just briefly go through this case. She was a 55-year-old lady, PS1, known case of hypothyroid. She presented to us with a T2N1 disease. Biopsy was IDC and triple negative disease. She underwent MRM. Histopathology was T2N1, medullary pattern, grade 3, LVI negative. So she was started on adjuvant chemotherapy. And after 3 cycles of AC-based chemotherapy, she developed a symptomatic COVID-19 infection, which was treated with steroids and remdesivir. Now she has been recovered and she is like 2 weeks after the infection. So again, the question goes to Dr. Akash, like, will there be any change in your adjuvant plan, or how much do you want to wait for that patient to start next cycle?
So sir, in my practice currently, we are looking at 3 parameters. They should have become COVID negative. They should be okay. At least ECOG PS 1, 0 to 2. And in that situation, we start them on chemotherapy. We do not unnecessarily wait for a fixed duration of period after they become negative. So, sir, for example, this lady becomes negative by day 14, day 15. We'll give her a cool down period of a week or so, and then would start on her own therapy. That's the practice that we are fighting, and we have not had an issue with any patients till now, by God's grace.
Dr. Akash, quick question. Are you routinely doing echoes in these patients before you start them again on chemotherapy? Because there are a lot of cardiac issues which are
coming. If you have to give them AC, doxorubicin-based therapy, we are getting it done. Otherwise, not. Okay. And surprisingly, we did not find a decreased ejection fraction in any of the patients that we have seen. And there are at least 10 odd patients with such scenarios.
Yeah, because our anesthetists have made it a protocol, because there were a couple of patients who underwent certain cardiac issues during surgery and after surgery. So any breast cancer patient who's recovered from surgery, even if they're young, they're getting a pre-op echo done before giving fitness. I don't know if that's the practice elsewhere. I'm just sharing what we are doing.
Sure.
Okay.
Ashish, I just want to add one thing. I would reassess the patient before taking up for surgery. If the patient is having a good response, I would continue chemotherapy. If the patient is not having a good response after 3 cycles, I might consider surgery now and then chemotherapy later on.
The surgery has already been done. This is post-surgery, sir. Neoadjuvant wasn't done in this patient.
Achha.
Post-MRM. Okay. Sir.
Achha. I just missed.
No worries. I also IDC, TNBC. Ideally, this patient should have had
yes.
NACT. Yes.
Ideally, yeah. Should have been given neoadjuvant in this COVID times, but it's...
Yeah.
My signal just came back now. Sorry.
Okay. So, I think... next slide, please. I think this case is over, and if we have any questions from the audience, we can take in next 5-10 minutes.
So we have multiple questions in the question answer section and also in the chat box.
Okay.
So would you want any help with that? Should I read the question, sir?
So one
okay.
question.
I can read by Dr. R.N. Tagore, the time interval between vaccination and due chemotherapy and vice versa. So Dr. Akash, would you like to answer?
Sir, I am requesting my patients to get their chemotherapy either before starting and give them a cool off period of a week's time, or to, if they are taking it in midst of their cycle, to take it in the 3rd week, and then we continue with chemotherapy in the routine times. Once their fever, etc., has settled for a couple of days. That is the only cool-off period that we are giving.
Okay. The next question is, what is the justification of stopping radiation in patients who are asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic for COVID, especially if they are well into their treatment schedule? Dr. Nishant, would you like to answer?
Sir, it is just because that patient is positive, we have to isolate the patient. So yeah. Maybe this is the reason. Definitely. We have to stop it.
Yeah, we have to isolate that patient because that patient can lead to very high chances of infection to the other patients who are going for it.
Yes.
Yeah, immunocompromised patients. So definitely. Can post-COVID 1 month patient 54 years who is diagnosed with breast cancer can undergo chemotherapy and is not vaccinated? I think Dr. Akash has already answered that question.
Yes.
She can undergo chemotherapy. What to do with those breast cancer patients locally advanced under AC regime, fixed third cycle and now COVID positive but no symptoms and CT value is 32. Continue chemo or wait till she comes negative?
So we wait till she comes negative. Once she is negative and her saturation is normal, she's not very dyspneic, we restart the chemotherapy. But we give a break. We would never give chemotherapy in a patient who is COVID positive.
Definitely. And the next question is, do you advise NACT for early breast cancer, say clinically T1 N0 instead of surgery? Since some OTR closed in view of oxygen shortage. So I think we have to see the molecular profile first, and then we have to take a call for these kind of patients to start them on chemotherapy, hormonal therapy. There are so many factors which we have to take into consideration regarding age, molecular profile, performance status, and the logistics. In general, with 30 years patient, right breast cancer, 5 cm tumor, cup size A with N2 axilla, metastatic workup normal, ER, PR, HER2 positive, would you think of endocrine therapy or chemotherapy?
We'll give chemotherapy in this lady. So in patients who are HER2 positive, if you do not give chemotherapy, they'll progress very rapidly. In ESMO, this category, there is high priority. We have to start chemo early.
Yeah, definitely. Then any PET CT scan done prior to starting treatment? I think he has asked this question to any specific case. What's the incidence of? I'm going to next case. 2 weekly or 3 weekly AC to choose?
Two weekly AC, sir. Definitely.
I think most of the institutes are practicing that only right now. Then what's the incidence of CA breast on chemotherapy developing COVID-19 infection? So what's the incidence? Do we have a consolidated data for this? I don't think so. Dr. Akash?
So around 10-15 of my patients developed COVID. All of them recovered except that one of them has developed mucormycosis. So we do not know what her report will be.
Okay. Yeah, because definitely there is a need to collect and compile the data regarding the incidence of the infections which are happening in these kind of cases. But definitely all the practicing guys, they are seeing the cases. Currently, uses of steroid is increased for COVID patient. Is it safe for cancer patients or not? Or treatment can be complete without steroid use? I think we can low dose steroids. Paclitaxel or nanopaclitaxel considering pre chemo steroid use?
So there is no advantage of giving nanopaclitaxel over paclitaxel unless there is a strict contraindication of steroid. Or if there is hypersensitivity. So it is cost effective, we give paclitaxel.
Okay. How many days would you wait after vaccination for chemo or surgery? I think we have operated few cases post-vaccination after 2 weeks time. I think everyone is following the same protocol, Dr. Nishant.
Yes, sir. We are waiting for 2 weeks after post-vaccination. Because the side effects of vaccination, some people, they get trouble after that. And they... effect of the immune response, it takes time. I just wanted to ask Dr. Akash regarding the vaccination in the cancer patients who are undergoing chemotherapy. Sir, don't you think when a patient is vaccinated and we again start the chemotherapy, the immune response goes down? And
sir, you're absolutely correct. So for this reason, in the initial part, say in Feb, March, we advise our patients not to take vaccination. That was the evidence at that time. We decided to not give them chemotherapy. But suddenly when the cases started rising, some of my colleagues lost their patients. So we aggressively asked patients to get them vaccinated. We thought that even if the efficacy goes down by 10, 20, 30%, they're getting some efficacy. So we asked them to get vaccinated. And we gave them a breather time only till such time that fever complication has gone, because we know that they will remain immunosuppressed for long even if we stop or give a break in chemotherapy. So we continued with the regimens as usual.
Sir, I was reading the NCCN guidelines for this COVID vaccination in the cancer patients. So they have said patients who had undergone stem cell transplant or CAR T cell therapies, or even in leukemia patients where aggressive chemotherapy is given, in those patients, the vaccine should not be given. They had also mentioned that they don't have any evidence regarding the vaccination, role of vaccination in the cancer patients who are being aggressively given chemotherapies.
Sure. So this, treating physicians have to understand that the evidence or the reason that they are quoting it is based on their evidences from acute leukemia, child immunization, or pneumococcal immunizations that we have had earlier. But this is a different scenario. Here, a large scale of population are getting infected, and the chances of your patients getting infected is far more. It is anecdotal, but in my city of the practicing people, the people who decided not to immunize their patients had more mortality in their patients as compared to others. Matlab, of course, I have no data to back it up, but I'm telling you amongst our colleagues, so we decided to immunize everyone.
Okay.
I would definitely agree with you, Doctor, on this, because the thing is that even if normal patients get vaccinated, still 30% of them will not develop an immune response. And with such kind of pandemic around, vaccination, the only thing it might happen is that they might not develop a response. That's the only thing which first can happen. First, but they should get vaccinated anyways.
Right. So I think we have answered most of the questions, and it was a very nice discussing with you all. Any comment from the organizing team?
One thing I want to ask all of you panelists, that is there like any, specifically for breast cancer patients who are taking hormone therapy, do you have any preference towards Covaxin versus Covishield, or if our patients are taking Covishield, any prophylactic anticoagulation or anything like that? Just a way thought I wanted.
Sir, abhi to the sovereign is deciding who gets what.
Yes.
No, but obviously now since people are getting options of paying and getting vaccinated, so Sputnik is coming and all. So. Any thoughts of
preference, sir? But any patient who is high risk or risk of getting clots, we are putting them in touch with our internal medicine team as well, and we are letting the internal medicine team decide whether to put on prophylactic anticoagulants for a certain amount of period or not.
Okay.
Sir, if we have some time, there are some questions in the chat box as well. So.
Okay. Still left. I think it's showing three questions.
Sir, in the chat box. Sir, with your permission, I'll read the question, sir, if that's okay.
Sure.
Yeah, so we have a question from Dr. Varsha. Can post-COVID lung patch appear as a metastatic node on lungs when newly diagnosed with breast cancer?
Yes, definitely. I think any infected nodules can show uptake on the PET scan. And we have to see the overall picture. What's the status of primary? What's the luminal status? Okay, Dr. Mandeep has, I think, already answered that question. a lot will depend on you. Okay, so Dr. Mandeep has, I think, already answered. If we see, so everything will depend upon these things, and he has already mentioned that it can mimic the metastatic lesion.
So shall I move on to the next question?
Yeah, definitely.
So what to do for patients who finish NACT and need surgery, but again, surgery not possible due to OT shutdown?
I think the cases who has completed the neoadjuvant chemotherapy, as Dr. Rohan mentioned, they are to be done on priority. But we can see ERPR positive, HER2 negative, and it's 6 cycles. We have to see what regime was given, because few people follow the 4AC40 protocol, few follow the 6FEC. So we have to see. And if the, I think chemotherapy is done and still we are not possible to operate, we can start hormonal, or we can, like in ERPR positive, I think we can start on hormonal therapy.
I think so. He's mentioned
till we get a slot.
TNBC. It's a TNBC is what he's mentioned. So think so. We have to carry out surgery. As I mentioned, that we are doing surgeries under paravertebral blocks also. So you know, if it's an oxygen crunch, there are many ways to circumvent that. But delaying it by a few weeks is not going to alter the outcome, but should not be delayed for a prolonged amount of time.
Definitely, Rohan, it's a paravertebral block is something which is really good thing, and it's a good option for to circumvent the oxygen crisis. Yeah. And I think if any of us is facing such kinds of issues, they can explore the option of paravertebral block.
So shall I move on to the next question?
Yes, you can.
We have a question from Dr. Ayan Bhattacharya. A patient of Hodgkin's lymphoma can't receive RCHOP. She must be having NHL, if I'm not mistaken.
Talking about the first case. It was NHL only. Okay.
So we have another question. In general, with 30 years patient, right breast, cancer 5 centimeters tumor in cup size A, with N2 axilla, metastatic workup, normal, ERPR, HER2 positive, would you think of endocrine therapy with chemotherapy?
I think that has been answered in the question answer session. Most agreed for chemotherapy.
So what is your choice of chemotherapy in non-hypertensive and non-diabetic 54 years female and is ERPR positive and HER2 new negative?
It would depend upon the stage. So if it is an advanced tumor, 4AC by 4T. If it is a T2N0 otherwise, but on molecular study or looks to be a high-risk tumor, 4TC or 6TC. Otherwise, a genetic profile, if it is low risk, no chemotherapy. So there's a 4AC by 4T or 4TC by 4 or slash 6TC. I meant 4TC slash 4-6TC, depending upon the risk stratification.
So can ERPR positive with HER2 negative after receiving 6 cycles of chemo, can undergo surgery or not?
So the ideal time of operating them is completing planned chemotherapies rather than giving break. So most should receive actually 4AC by 4T if they are receiving it as a new adjuvant. So if it is planned 6 and they are finished, they can undergo. Otherwise, they should complete their 8 cycles and then undergo surgery.
So we have a question from Dr. Arun. So what to do to those breast cancer locally advanced patient who are COVID-19 positive for the second time with no symptoms and CT value is 32 and above? Should we continue chemo or deferring?
We should defer the chemo. So in an active infection, if you give chemotherapy, there are chances of flare up, plus there are chances of exposing a lot of other people. It is better to defer chemotherapy in such situations.
Perfect, sir. We're done with the questions. Oh, so sorry, sir. We have one more question from Dr. Nitika Singh. Is there any specific therapy for post-COVID hyperglycemia in breast cancer patients? Also, are there any other parameters to keep in mind?
Post-COVID, what?
Hyperglycemia. So, sir, most of our patients who have COVID and they have hyperglycemia is because of steroid usage. We handle it as we handle hyperglycemia with steroids. Other time, if the steroid is not required, to taper and stop it, to add OHAs, and if not, insulin. But it does not change the chemotherapy plan.
Thank you so much, sir. Ashish sir, Akash sir, if Mandeep sir, if anyone wants to make any comments, so please feel free.
Just one thing from the panel. Do any of us have considered the option of, during COVID times, any option of home chemotherapy? Or it's not a safe option?
So for that's a good question. I think so, Dr. Akash, do you want to answer that before
I could not listen. The
home chemotherapy.
Sir, I could not get the question. Sorry.
Chemotherapy at home.
Akash, I'm asking that any of us.
Chemotherapy at home. Okay.
Sir, I haven't allowed any patient for that. A lot of people had asked that option, but I did not.
But what about if they're just asking for an LHRH analog injection?
So, zolintonic acids, ask them to get it either at home or a nearby nursing home. I don't call them.
So, I mean, I am also fine with getting those done, but getting chemotherapy done at home is something which a lot of my patients have also asked, but I have refrained from, I am not a huge fan of it right now.
Yes, sir, we don't recommend them. Otherwise, they will go one step ahead, the patients.
Actually, it happens that the medico-legal risk remains yours, but you are not administering the drug. So, yes. I think it is not.
Yes. So for patients who are like routinely receiving Herceptin, like is there 11 cycle, 12 cycle of Herceptin or something like that?
So, what we
is
have
that
done,
an option? Or?
So, what we have done is patients who are receiving therapy, which otherwise do not need a lot of monitoring, we ask them to take it at a center near their home, but not at home. Sir. To find a non-COVID center, something near their home, they don't have to travel, but not at home.
Yes.
Apart from zolindonic acid, leuprolide injections, apart from that, any cytotoxic or anti-chemotherapy drug, we want them to take it under supervision of a medical professional.
One more thing which I would like to discuss is that there are a couple of patients of mine who developed axillary lymphadenopathy after the vaccine. Very clearly, which we should highlight, that they should take the vaccine in the opposite side. And yes. If that axillary lymphadenopathy has developed, give a course of antibiotics and then follow up these patients. You don't want to miss out on recurrence and just miss it for
yes.
the active lymphadenopathy.
Definitely.
Yes, sir, please go.
One on the lighter note. How are we, since we all deal with, we are like cancer physicians and we have good experience of monoclonal antibodies, what is the opinion of the panel of Regeneron, which is coming for the COVID?
Sir, we are not able to hear you.
Yeah, I just wanted to, what is the opinion of the house regarding Regeneron, the monoclonal antibody for COVID, which is being launched by Roche?
I'm not aware of it.
It was the, if you have heard that Donald Trump speech, it is a monoclonal antibody against S protein, which has to be given at early stages of COVID.
Okay.
During day 2 to day 10, I suppose, if I'm not wrong.
And then he received it too. But yeah. I thought that I am not aware about it being available in India and its usage.
So it's not available yet. Roche is trying to bring it to India, but I just thought that since a lot of medical oncologists, like you guys are there, so what is your opinion regarding that?
It'll add to the one more weapon in the armamentarium against the virus once it is available. But I hope by the time it is available, the epidemic proportions will not remain this big, hopefully.
Sure.
But I think it is a monoclonal antibody only targeting the proteins of the COVID in the active phase. It will help the patient, and the patients recover very early with this.
I was reading in that that article, that FDA guideline, that they have not recommended for cancer patients. Why I asked this question is that are cancer patients who unfortunately get COVID, so should we advocate of getting him in the guidelines for that, for this or not? Their guidelines, basically it's diabetes, it's hypertension, it's COPD, age more than 65 years, chronic renal disease. But I did not see any cancer patient, cancer as a guideline for administering these drugs.
Sir, unless the data is out, I don't think so we can comment on it, on the cancer patients.
Sure.
So if there are no more, yeah. So please go ahead.
Yeah, I think all the questions has been answered, and most of the thing has been discussed. So it was a very nice discussion. I think we can close the session.
Yes, sir. I'll just request Mr. Neeraj Luthra, Vice President of Business Development of OncoStem Diagnostics, to please give the closing remarks. Over to you, Neeraj.
Good evening, all doctors. Oh my God, I would say that it has been a momentous day. Today we discussed, shared, and learned about the evidence and response needed to achieve better health for all breast cancer patients in COVID times. I would therefore like to congratulate all of you for such a successful event and such fruitful discussions. My special thanks goes to Dr. Rohan Khandelwal for presenting the principles in management of breast cancer. I thank Dr. Ashish Jagetia for moderating this event and being the nucleus and powerhouse for this event. I would also like to thank Dr. Nishant from Ludhiana, Dr. Mandeep from Fortis Hospital, and Dr. Akash Tiwari from Indore for contributing and sharing experiences of treatment. Thank you so very much for being with us. It was our pleasure to hear from you today. Thanks a lot.